music thanatologist here at St. Vincent. Music thanatology is a palliative care discipline and resource, and part of the supportive care services offered without charge to patients and families through pastoral services. I am so very pleased to be offering this afternoon's reflection for many reasons, but mostly because this lectureship is partially funded through the generosity of Dr. Fred Ng and his family. I was fortunate to get to know Dr. Ng and to hear his beautiful piano music and to hear his exquisite bass voice. Dr. Ng was passionate about the arts and music and recognized their potential as healing agents. I treasure the conversations we had about music and medicine, and about music as medicine. So today I'd like to offer a piece of music composed by Kim Robertson called Bittersweet. In it, I hope you can hear the joy and sorrow that often accompanies our work with palliative care patients and their loved ones. Thank you.
Thank you. Connections team, and it's a delight to have you. In just a moment, I'm going to introduce Dr. Rabow. Our forum this afternoon on palliative care for the soul is sponsored by the Pastoral Services Department here, as well as the Providence Center for Healthcare Ethics. And today, this is sponsored by, as Laura mentioned, by Dr. Frederick Ng and his family. As mentioned, he was an accomplished musician. He's also an anesthesiologist. Had a strong desire to care for others and to contribute to society. And with his belief in music and the arts, we are really glad that he is Cinda is here today. And thank you for coming. And we're just so glad that this was able to be sponsored by him, but also Dr. Robert Goldman and John Berlin, physicians that have been recognized for their outstanding role in palliative care and innovators in that. The palliative care was established in their honor through the St. Vincent's Foundation, and we're also going to be sponsoring the medical grand rounds at PPMC tomorrow, so you're welcome to attend there if possible. Dr. Rabow, I keep wanting to say it wrong. He's a professor of clinical medicine and urology at the University of California, San Francisco. He is the inaugural Helen Diller Family Chair in Palliative Care at the Helen Diller Family Comprehensive Cancer Center. Board certified in internal medicine and hospice and palliative care, Dr. Rabow is founding director of a leading outpatient palliative care consultation program called the Symptom Management Service at UCSF, Helen Diller Family Comprehensive Cancer Center. He's also the founding director of the UCSF Mount Zion Hospital Palliative Care Consultation Services. Dr. Rabow attended UCSF for medical school and general internal medicine residency training. He completed fellowships at UCSF in general medicine as well as in medical education research. His widely published research work is in palliative care, family caregiving, and end-of-life care education. He is a national expert in outpatient palliative care research and service delivery. He also serves as a consultation to U.S. hospitals and hospital systems throughout America working and trying to develop their own palliative care services. Dr. Rabow is a member of the UCSF Academy of Medical Educators. He serves as the director for the Center of the Study of the Healer Arts at the Institute for the Study of Health and Illnesses at Commonweal in California. He's also the assistant editor at the world's best-selling annually updated general medicine book textbook, Current Medical Diagnosis and Treatment. Also, Dr. Rabow served with the Soros Foundation Project, Death in America, as a faculty scholar and has been recognized for his work in palliative care as a 2012 recipient of the Kunef Dixon Foundation Physician Award from the Hastings Center. Whew, that's a lot. A very accomplished gentleman, and we are so delighted to have him here. So make welcome Dr. Rabow.
Well, thank you all very much for having me here. It's been a wonderful day so far, and I appreciate so many of you joining this afternoon. And I really appreciated the musical introduction and the words introduction. The music may be closer to the topic for today's discussion this afternoon, which is palliative care of the soul. So I want to read you a poem from Mary Oliver, who is probably the patron saint, poet of palliative care. This is called The Clam. The Clam. Each one is a small life, but sometimes long, if its place in the universe is not found out. Like us, they have a heart and a stomach. They know hunger and probably a little satisfaction too. Do not mock them for their gentleness. They have a muscle that loves being alive. They pull away from the light. They pull down. They hold themselves together. They refuse to open. But sometimes they lose their place and are tumbled shoreward in a storm. Then they pant. They fill with sand. They have no choice but must open to the smallest crack. Then the fire of the world touches them. Perhaps on such days they too begin the terrible effort of thinking, of wondering who and what and why. If they can bury themselves again in the sand, they will. If not, they are sure to perish, though not quickly. They also have resources beyond the flesh. They also try very hard not to die. So I guess the major premise of my comments this afternoon are, if that's what it's like for clams, imagine what it's like for us humans. These deep issues of meaning, spirituality, existential truth for all of us. So today I'm hoping to run through a few major general areas, although this is not a very deeply evidence-based academic talk. So I'm hoping that you'll be able to sit back and enjoy your lunch and let some thoughts run through your head. So we'll talk about spiritual and existential issues in palliative care, thinking some about suffering and meaning. We'll think about what the palliative care clinician's role is vis-a-vis patient spirituality, specifically thinking about bearing witness. And we'll think about the patient-clinician relationship in palliative care, thinking about connection and intimacy, and importantly, about the sustainability of the work that we do. And I think for the purposes of our discussion this afternoon, I'm going to be talking about palliative care and thinking about palliative care clinicians, but of course, I think all of us are engaged in many ways around these issues with our parents, so I presume that if you're a clinician in any form, from any discipline, some of these thoughts will apply to the work that you do. So Albert Einstein said, "Not everything that can be measured is important, and not everything that is important can be measured." So it's a bit of a caveat that I want to make, which is to say many of these thoughts are influenced from the medical literature, from expert opinion, but I don't claim in any way to know everything that I'm talking about or to be the expert in the room on all these issues. Another way to say it is from Oscar Wilde, "When one has weighed the sun in the balance and measured the steps of the moon and mapped out the seven heavens star by star, there still remains oneself. Who can calculate the orbit of the soul?" Not my plan. I'm not going to try and calculate the orbit of the soul, but I do really want everyone to think about what this means for you in your work. What resonates for you? What thoughts do you have about this? So Ira Byock, who is here and a few years ago, and I know, and is now part of Providence, said, about palliative care, symptom management is our first priority, but not our ultimate goal. So what is the ultimate goal of palliative care? And I would argue that it has something to do with spiritual well-being. A couple of years ago, Christina Pilchowski led a consensus conference and got together a whole room, hundreds of palliative care clinicians and chaplains and nursing and physician social work experts. And we actually were able, after a few punches were thrown, we were actually able to come up with a definition of spirituality, and here it is. "Spirituality is the aspect of humanity that refers to the way individuals seek and express meaning and purpose, and the way they experience their connectedness to the moment, to self, to others, to nature, and to the significant or sacred." And I've highlighted three terms there that are going to be important. We're going to come back to over the course of the next hour or so: humanity, and meaning, and connectedness. So let those terms sort of stick in your mind. So spirituality is something that all humans have. The same way we all have bodies and we all have emotions, we all have brains. We have this domain, this scale, this part of ourselves that is about spirituality, is about meaning. It's human across our whole population, across the whole world. And our children have it, and our parents have it, and we have it. This is a picture of my son Emerson a few years ago holding a coffin with our family hamster Henry in it. That's Henry. Henry died. And Emerson, of his own creativity, of his own interest, went and found this old iPhone case. The iPhone 3 case serves as a great hamster coffin, I might add, with the desire to give Henry a proper burial. And that was Emerson, who was 8 at the time, who had a spirituality, who had some sense of the meaning and the majesty of that moment. In some ways, Emerson understood spirituality as including the concept of suffering. He was sad. He was suffering. Howard Brody defined suffering: at the root of suffering is a sense that what ought to be whole is being split apart. Eric Cassell said, a disintegration of the parts of the self. Dis-ease. A series of losses of identity. So loss can lead to suffering because loss typically creates a crisis of identity, which often leads us into a type of a spiritual crisis. We lose our wholeness. We lose parts of ourselves. And here in this hospital, you see that all day, every day. Who are you if you are not able-bodied, if you are not working, if you are not walking? Who are you if you do not have your hair, if you don't have your breasts, if you don't have your erectile function, if you don't have the future that you thought you would have? Mr. West said the essential element of all the world's literature and thought is answering the question, who am I? Mr. West, for those of you who do not know, was my 9th grade English teacher. Who am I? So if that's a core of spirituality, and if illness and dis-ease brings us to a series of these losses throughout the course of life, throughout the course of illness, you can see that healthcare and palliative medicine in particular are all about spiritual issues, about loss, about dignity, about hope, about isolation and connection, about meaning and purpose, closure, legacy, mortality, and what happens after we die. So palliative care is a spiritual focus. And it raises the question then, how do you know when you're standing on spiritual ground? And I would argue that this is the face of spiritual crisis. And it should look familiar to you because this is the face of most of the people in the beds here in this hospital. I think we can get a sense that the person before us is facing a spiritual crisis because of certain common things that we see. I had a patient who said, Dr. Rabow, When I can no longer wipe my own butt, will you kill me? That was a spiritual crisis. There's lots in there, of course. But among the issues is one of identity and meaning and hope. So I see spiritual crises when I have patients who lose or gain long-held beliefs or practices. When people start going to church or stop going to church. When people are seeking forgiveness or feeling alone or isolated or abandoned by God, a particularly important spiritual crisis. When people develop depression or anxiety, isolation or anger, those can be signs of spiritual crisis. When people start or stop taking medicines, that can be a sign of spiritual crisis. People have symptoms that I can't quite explain. That might be spiritual crisis. And importantly, when I hear particular questions, what I've called with my mentor, Steve McPhee, the dreaded questions, I always wonder if I'm not talking with someone who's in a spiritual crisis. The dreaded questions are questions that you dread, questions that you don't want to hear and you don't quite know how to answer. We hear these all the time. A patient who asks, why me? Or why now? Or what does this mean? Is there hope? Can I be forgiven? Or what happens when I die? Or how will I be remembered? So the physician says to the patient, there's no easy way I can tell you this, so I'm sending you to someone who can. So yes, this room has, I know, lots of people you can send patients to. There's lots of chaplains in the room. There's lots of social workers in the room. There's lots of nurses in the room. There's lots of physicians in the room. There are people in this room who you know within your institution are good people to send patients who are in spiritual crisis to. But I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about referring on to someone else. I'm not talking about referring on to the expert. I'm not even talking about bringing in the harper to play something beautiful and restful and comforting. I'm really talking about this issue of what would it be like if you did not refer this person on, if you said the first thing, if you started the conversation, if you initiated the spiritual care. So spiritual care might be defined as discovering, reverencing, and tending to the spiritual issues of another, helping people achieve healing and wholeness. And we know that clergy are religious leaders and that chaplains are healthcare professionals dedicated to doing this and trained at doing this. But what am I? As a palliative care clinician, what am I? What are you as a nurse in Providence Hospital? What's our role vis-a-vis patients' spirituality, spiritual crises? So the woman says, there's an elephant in the room and no zookeeper. And this is a situation maybe you find yourself in, I certainly do a lot, where there's all this stuff happening and you're kind of looking around for someone to be in charge and it's you. You're the person who people are turning to for direction, for comfort. So is it our job? Is it our job to address, to respond, to relate in some way to patient spirituality? And I'm going to make an argument that it is for a few different lines of reasoning. And here's the first one. Number one, the customer is always right. So we know that essentially all Americans, up to 98% of Americans, say that they believe in God. And importantly, 94% of Americans feel that their physical and their spiritual health is equally important. So whatever you think you're doing here at Providence in terms of dealing with people's physical health, it matters to most of them almost as much what's going on with their spiritual health. Most people, most Americans want spirituality included in their medical care. People say almost universally that spiritual beliefs would be a comfort to them, and two-thirds want their physicians to consider their spiritual needs. A third of people want to be asked about their spirituality during routine clinical visits. A third of people want to be asked about it during routine visits. And importantly, 10%, one out of every 10 people says that they would give up time, give up some of the time that we're spending talking about other healthcare issues to talk about their spiritual beliefs. At the end of life in particular, spirituality, I think, is important. About half say that spirituality would influence their decisions at the end of life, and now two-thirds want to be asked about spirituality by their clinician. So we need to deal with spirituality because our customer, who's always right, wants us to. The other reason, the other opportunity to deal with spirituality of our patients is that there's an amazing opportunity for growth at the end of life. When people are facing the end of life, we can think of it appropriately as another stage in the developmental series of stages that people go through. It's awfully exciting when babies are born. And we appreciate that there's lots of things going on, lots of learning, lots of opportunity. The same is true at the end of life for many people. That growth at the end of life is part of lifelong development. The end of life, the end period of life, may be a time to promote personal integrity, to enhance relationships, to confront and prepare for the end of life. And at the end of life, when people think about the silver lining of getting a bad disease, people often talk about finding meaning. People often find gratitude for things that they might not have appreciated before. And there are some who even reach what they might call, and we might call, transcendence in the face of their impending loss of life. So I know growth is possible because of a patient named Grace, who was a woman in her 50s who was at the end stages of ovarian cancer. And she had a daughter who was 18 or 19, who, like many of your 18 and 19-year-old daughters, wanted to get a tattoo. And she asked Grace about getting this tattoo, and Grace said, "No way, no how, no daughter of mine's gonna get a tattoo." And it was a real struggle. And I kept on thinking to myself, wow, what a silly thing to be spending your time, the two of you, fighting about, thinking about, arguing about at the end of life, at the end of Grace's life. And then her daughter showed up with that tattoo. She didn't ask for permission. She begged for forgiveness, for sure, but she didn't need to, because when Grace saw this, the shamsa, a Jewish symbol of love and protection that she had tattooed, when she saw that she had put her mother's hand on her back to go through life with that sense of connection and direction, Grace grew. And Grace accepted the idea of her daughter getting a tattoo. And ultimately, our growth may be so profound that we can reach a place of surrender. Not a submission, and not giving up. Think about surrender really as a choice to accept reality. The reality that we know and the reality that is mystery as well. You surrender to what is going on. It's not a question of if death is going to happen. We know death is going to happen. It's a question of whether or not we can be open to it, whether or not we can be vulnerable to it. And openness to what is next, which I would define as hope. So Robert Frost said, "Hope does not lie in a way out, but a way through." And that's what we have. We don't have a way out. None of us do. What we have is the possibility, the opportunity to find a way through this situation that we find ourselves in of mortality, of loss. So I'm going to make a few recommendations about how we as clinicians might interact with the spiritual issues of our patients. I call these reasonable clinician guidelines for spiritual care or palliative care of the soul. And of course, I'm the one who came up with that word reasonable. You may not think that they're reasonable, but try these on for size. There's four of them. An invitation to bring spirituality into the room, a response to people's expressions of spiritual belief, a prescription, which is comes from my role as a physician, thinking about being able to prescribe things, and then a caution, this idea of handling these important existential issues with care. So let's go to A, the invitation, asking, listening, and understanding. So the invitation really begins with an ask. It begins with you asking patients something that signifies your invitation to them that spirituality is okay. It's okay with you. Chaplains walk around with this. It says chaplain on their name tags. People are like, oh yeah, I can talk about spirituality with that person. But you walk around with social worker or nurse or physician on your name tag. How are you communicating to people that this key domain of humanity is something that you're comfortable, willing to talk about? And I would say it starts off by asking a screening question. It really helps establish a relationship with patients, align patients with you, and invites into the room at least a short discussion about these issues of spiritual meaning. You can ask something like, is faith important to you in your illness? Or how can I integrate your spirituality into your healthcare? A very, very useful screening question. How can I integrate your spirituality into your healthcare? You've at least asked the screening question. Screening questions are awesome. So I ask, in general medicine, I ask all my patients, are you sexually active? And if so, with men, women, or both? Or do you have any issues around your sexuality that you would like to discuss? And I had an elderly man respond to me, no, nothing to say, nothing to talk about. And I said, okay, we moved on. And then he was lost to follow-up for 5 years. And he showed up again after 5 years on my schedule. He sat down, and before I even opened his electronic medical record, he said to me, you know, I lied. I was like, you haven't said anything yet. I mean, it was literally the first thing out of his mouth. I lied. You asked me when I saw you last about sexuality, and I do have some things I want to talk about. Screening questions work. He remembered, and he came back to answer the question. So after asking comes this other part. So this is what physicians do. I fully admit this is a physician cartoon. It says, Stanley, we need to talk, so please don't interrupt. Right? So if you're going to ask a question, your next responsibility is to listen. And listening is closer to bearing witness than it is to doing anything else. Listening is not trying to fix the problem. It's trying to hear the problem. The old Buddhist adage, don't just do something, sit there. Hard to do. For some of us, harder than others, but hard to do, to actually listen. To listen generously, not to try and assess, not to try and diagnose, not to try and do anything other to understand what's true for the other person. Reverend Steele said, to listen another's soul into a condition of disclosure and discovery may be almost the greatest service that any human being ever performs for another. So there's an opportunity to perform the greatest service any human can perform for another, to listen. And it stems from listening that our next job is something around understanding what people are saying. And I try and understand people's religious statements and people's spiritual statements. So I say something complex and medical like, what? I say something like, oh, tell me what you mean. Or this is the one that combines a lot of respect with the need to understand, which is, what you're saying is really, really important. Can you say it again so I can make sure I understand? How often in your day-to-day life does someone ask you to say more? How often in your day-to-day life does someone say, what you have to say is so important to me, I really, really want to understand it, so I'm going to ask you a follow-up question. I'm going to ask you a clarifying question. Yeah? At the very least, if I have to move the crucifix over to listen to someone's heart, I at least mention it. Oh, I noticed this thing. And people will say, oh, that's nothing. Or, yeah, my grandmother gave that to me right before she died of the same disease you're about to diagnose me with. Right? I mean, it can have anything from no meaning to lots and lots of meaning. And as we start to try and understand our patients and what our patients say, we have the opportunity to gently explore meaning. So exploration sounds expensive. It sounds like it takes a lot of time, but it doesn't necessarily. Exploration can be a wonderful way to connect in much deeper ways, very effectively, with your patients. So I have something called the existential review of symptoms. So we, in medicine, we have the review of symptoms. So you go from head to toe and ask people, you know, how does your hair feel and how are your eyebrows and what's your nose doing? We go through the whole thing. So there's an existential review of systems as well, which is taken from Martin Buber, the intrapersonal, interpersonal, and transpersonal. So those domains. And you can think about a screening question in each of these domains. So thinking about intrapersonal, you can say, what does your illness or your dying mean to you? And then stop talking. See what people have to say. Interpersonal, you can say, to whom does your illness or your dying matter? So powerful question. Because anything you get means a lot. To whom does it matter? Oh, well, I've got these people in my life. That matters to you, to know who these people are. Or when people say, no one. That matters. Or transpersonal, what is your source of strength or hope? When I'm sitting in clinic talking to someone and they're describing the situation of them being these incredible heroes dealing with this incredible thing that I can hardly even imagine myself dealing with, I think to myself, God, what is their source of strength? And you can actually ask that question, and people can actually respond. And sometimes people will talk about their religious belief or their spiritual beliefs. So you can invite spirituality into the room. And once it's in the room, it is your obligation to respond. And you know how to respond. It's been trained out of many of us. Because we're told we have to come up with an answer rather than a basic human response. And sometimes we forget that we have within us everything we need to respond to suffering in the world, because we are fellow humans with people. So we can respond. We can be sad. We can be sorry. We can say, I am sorry. God, I went 5 years in the cancer center practicing palliative care before I realized that I was really sad that people got cancer, and I was sad when I heard about it for the first time, and I could say so. And I started telling people when I heard their story that I was sorry that they got cancer. We can say something, there's a paper about this by Tim Quill, we can say something like, I wish things were different. If you do wish that things were different, you can wish for a miracle even if you don't believe in miracles. You can wish. You can offer empathy in the ways that they teach healthcare learners about empathy, right? So you can reflect back, you can normalize, you can validate back, you can express empathy. But ultimately, you can simply listen and bear witness. If you are sad, you can cry. There's a lot of crying that's gone on in the history of US healthcare in hallways, wasted a bit in hallways, for patients not to be able to see that you care. Patients and families, the number one thing that they want from their clinicians is to know that they care. If you care, get credit for that. If you care, get credit for it. Now, I'm not talking about losing it. I'm not talking about losing control. I'm not talking about not being professional. I'm talking about being human. Yeah? Your electronic medical record will not cry, but you can. And ultimately, our job is to be responsive, not responsible. We're not answering cognitive questions. We are responding as humans. And ultimately, the best response may be presence. It may be to be there, not to abandon your patient, to sit there in silence. So Rod Seeger, who retired after 30 years of the head chaplain at UCSF, where I come from, said, "I never discuss theology with the dying. I listen for the affect." So I thought to myself, if the chaplain doesn't talk about theology, then I guess I don't have to either. Right? I can just listen for the affect. And we can respond with silence. So silence is an amazing thing. Even just that moment was enough for many of us to get us into this room. Long enough to have people recognize, oh, I'm here and I'm listening and he's up there and he's not talking and what's going on? And who are we? And what is this? What does this all mean? We're in a room together. Oh, I'm sitting next to someone here. Yeah. Silence is an incredibly powerful tool, and most psychologists say what comes up after a period of silence is typically more important than what was being talked about beforehand. So I had a resident who I was saying, he was telling me about a woman he was seeing in general medicine who was depressed, and I was saying, oh, he should try sitting in silence with her for just a moment. And he said to me, "Dr. Rabow, if I had to spend one more moment in the room in silence with that woman, it would drive me insane." And that's the point. Not to drive him insane, but empathy. If he has difficulty just experiencing what it's like to be her, to be with her for even just a few moments, imagine what it's like for her to be her. That's empathy. And we can sometimes feel that most strongly when we're not being distracted by a plan, by a prognosis, by data, by a description, by direction, and just there present. There's data. There's data for the clinical effectiveness of empathy and understanding. There's data for the effectiveness of being responsive to our patients and families. There's data about improved satisfaction. There's data about improved quality of life. There's data about decreased depression just for not saying anything, just for listening. And there's lots of data showing improved clinical outcomes, headache outcomes, medicine compliance for just being responsive. Here's an interesting meta-analysis of randomized trials looking at experiments where clinicians were randomized to respond in a very stereotypical way or not to respond to a patient's expression of need. There's a meta-analysis of different empathetic studies. And it showed an effect size there, the meta-analysis. These are the individual trials, and the meta-analysis was 0.11, showing that these interventions of empathy were better than placebo. They worked better than nothing, which is our comparison. So empathy works. And what's notable and where the title comes from is that the effect size for aspirin to prevent heart attacks is only 0.08. So the effect size of empathy is stronger than the effect of taking aspirin to prevent heart attacks or quitting smoking for men in terms of mortality. It is more important for you to be empathic with your patients than it is to get your male patients to quit smoking in terms of the size of the effect. So here's the prescription. The physician says to the patient, you're 57 years old, I'd like to get that down a bit. So realistically, there are some prescriptions I can't write. I've tried writing prescriptions for trips to Hawaii, they never work. But there are some things that we can do. So consider a prescription. There's some things in the literature that have good evidence behind them that we can prescribe, we can arrange for patients to do that have good clinical outcomes. So there's something called life review or dignity therapy. Harvey Chachinov has populated this and done great research showing randomized trials that dignity therapy, life review, videotapes of people's life stories work to improve quality of life, decrease caregiver burden, and all sorts of wonderful outcomes. Bill Breitbart has studied meaning-directed therapy in support groups from a psychiatric perspective and also showed good outcomes in terms of mood disorders. There's lots of data emerging around gratitude and legacy for people who are at the end of life in terms of collecting stories and offering legacy to loved ones. There's benefits from a spiritual leader or guidance from simply volunteering, right? You thought things were bad when you didn't have any shoes until you met someone who didn't have any feet, right? So sometimes volunteering really helps people put things in perspective. And then gratitude practice, something that I've built into our regular weekly meeting. We do a gratitude circle as part of our interdisciplinary team meeting at the end of every visit, of every session, every week. And I have people who come to the meeting just for the gratitude circle. They don't really care that much about talking about patients, but they love going around and hearing what people are grateful for. So, you guys know me relatively well now. It's been 50 minutes or so. You know, kind of touchy-feely, you know, sort of San Francisco-like, Portland-like, I hazard to say. And my wife is too. And this is a picture of the hand of my father-in-law, who is not like that at all. He's from New England. He's really sort of stiff upper lip. He kind of doesn't agree with anything I believe in. So we have this tradition at our house. At Christmas dinner, we invite everyone who's at the table at Christmas dinner that year to do an outline of their hand in indelible marker on the tablecloth. So we've got people's hands. So Ham, his name is Hamilton, says, ah! That's usually how he starts most of his sentences. Ah! That's a stupid idea. Why do I want to do that? Why are you writing on the tablecloth anyways? You shouldn't have pens out on a white tablecloth. Just on and on and on. And meanwhile, my daughter, that's her, is tracing his hand as he's complaining to us. And thank God now we have Ham's hand outlined in this legacy tablecloth. The simplest prescription I give is the four things that Ira Byock and others have said need to be said between people who care about each other at the close of a relationship. So when someone's dying, these might be very, very useful things. People come up to me and say, I don't know what to say. I've loved this person for 60 years, but I don't know what to say right now as they're dying. And I often will give a prescription about the four statements of closure. Forgive me. I forgive you. Thank you. And I love you. And very often people just need like the first one and then they're off to the races, right? They can figure out what to do from there. Some people add a couple of others. Some people talk about saying goodbye specifically. And people who are really with it will often want their loved ones to know that I'll be okay without you. Some people don't like that idea. Other people like have already planned who you're going to get dating as soon as I'm gone kind of thing. So everyone's different, but there's at least four things that we can all agree on. Forgive me, I forgive you, thank you, and I love you. So the fourth point I'd make is about having some caution. Spirituality is powerful stuff. Some people might define it as the most important thing in the world, the thing that matters most to people. So there's some risks in engaging in conversations about spirituality. So we have to pay attention to the possibility that we may need help, we may need to be referring, we will, for some patients, need to be referring to our spirituality experts, our trained and certified experts. So we may need to get good at asking the screening question, do you have someone to talk to about spiritual matters, about referring for particularly complex, difficult situations? So spirituality carries some risks to patients. We know that there's a power differential in healthcare, right? There's a patient who's naked lying down, and we're dressed and standing up. Like, there's the power differential at just the pure physical level. So some people may not feel comfortable talking about this with you or talking about it honestly. We know there's negative outcomes associated with spiritual distress. So people who feel abandoned by God are statistically more likely to die than people who don't. So there's negative outcomes associated with some elements of spirituality. And of course, there's cultural and ethnic diversity that's beyond any of our abilities to become experts in. So we have to be humble about asking for direction around this. So there's possible risks to the patient, for sure, and we're going to talk about this as the last bit of my time, really recognizing our own limitations and our own potential to really engage in this. We may have limited desire. We may have limited expertise. We have limited skill or comfort in talking about spiritual issues. There is clearly the potential for deep meaning and satisfaction, but this kind of work asks us to be truly present in the room, to face our own story. And so it requires something of us. It requires something of us. So the last slides, the last part of my talk is really about the spiritual lessons for the palliative care clinician. For clinicians dealing with patients who have a spirituality, which is all of us, what are the lessons we can take away? So the first one is kind of the duh slide, as my son would say. Bearing witness is hard. This is hard work. We're dealing with a whole series of impossibilities at the end of life, the ultimate uncertainty at the end of life, the dreaded questions we cannot answer. Wanting something with all your force that you will not get. Having this not be in our control, something that our patients face fundamentally in the setting of illness. And facing the duality of end-of-life care. I say this all the time, even though it's impossible, right? Hope for the best, prepare for the worst. How the heck are you going to do that? And yet that's what we're trying to do. Hope for the best and prepare for the worst. And it's difficult emotionally and it's difficult spiritually for us because we're facing suffering, and we're facing regret, and we're facing anger, and we're facing our own burnout, and we're facing a sense of failure. That makes this work very hard for us. So The Onion, a respected medical journal, had a headline, "World Death Rate Holding Steady at 100%. Many suggest that the high mortality rate represents a massive failure on the part of the planet's healthcare workers, right? With all due respect to people fighting disease, us, when we cure the number one cause of death in the United States, the next morning, do not be disappointed to wake up to realize that there is another number one cause of death in the United States. Yeah? Mortality is ours to sit with, to stay with, to do something about. Rachel Remen, who wrote Kitchen Table Wisdom, said, "The expectation that we can be immersed in suffering and loss daily and not be touched by it is as unrealistic as expecting to be able to walk through water without getting wet." We're going to get wet. By definition, we're going to get wet. And we know what happens if we try to just avoid that, pretend like we were dry. We know that avoiding grief leads to burnout. We see grief, we see sadness in the hospital sometimes as shameful or unprofessional. People who get waylaid by some trivial thing like sadness about a patient. Yeah? On to the next, on to the next, on to the next. You got a busy schedule. But we know that there's implications of that kind of avoidance. That clinicians who avoid their own grief distance themselves from patients and they are more likely to recommend futile care. And there's spillover at home. Most people probably get that, have had that maybe last night. Yeah? We come home impatient, irritable, exhausted, and we burn out. So the question then is, what is the solace for your soul? I know you came here thinking this was going to be about solace for the souls of patients, and I'm kind of doing a little switcheroo, but not quite, because my argument is that we're two sides of the same coin. So first, we need to take care of ourselves, right? Like, everyone's right in telling us that we need to exercise and get good sleep and do all those things. That's absolutely necessary, but it's not sufficient. A really nice glass of wine may be necessary, but it's not sufficient for your soul. Okay, so I want you to run, and I want you to be in control, and I want you to use your denial mechanism. I want all of those things. Those are necessary, but they are not sufficient. So what else do we need? Viktor Frankl wrote about people in concentration camps in Germany, a book called Man's Search for Meaning, and said, man is not destroyed by suffering, he is destroyed by suffering without meaning. So remember back to that definition about humanity and meaning and connection. So this is the meaning part. Nietzsche said, he who has a why to live can bear with almost any how. So take care of yourselves, but we have to figure out what matters to us. So this phrase, what are you doing, form filler, is really a modification of an old Sufi parable that I will tell you, adapted for us in modern electronic medical records. Yeah. So the Sufi parable is about hundreds and hundreds of years ago in the Middle East, there was a grand stone temple being built. And you're there observing the construction of this temple. And you see all sorts of people working, taking these rocks and carving them into blocks to build the temple. And you see one man, and you go up to this man working, and you say, tell me, stonecutter, what are you doing? And the stonecutter says, are you stupid? Yeah, I saw you up on the hill there watching me. You know what I'm doing. They bring me this rock, and I carve it into a block, and they take that away, and then they bring me another rock, and I do it again, and I do it all day, and I'll do it every day for my whole life. Get out of here. So you take the hint, and you walk away, and you notice another man doing the same work. And you walk up to this gentleman and you say, stonecutter, tell me, what are you doing? And he looks up at you and he says, well, they bring me these rocks and I cut them into blocks. And for that, they pay me a wage. And with that money, I buy food and clothing and shelter for my family. I am providing for my family. So you take that, and then you go and you spy a third man who's working as a stonecutter, and you walk up to that gentleman and you say, sir, what are you doing, stonecutter? And he looks up at you and he's got this shining light in his face, and he says, ah, I am building a temple that will stand for 1,000 years, and all people far and wide will come here and find peace and glory in the universe. So we come back to the question, what are you doing, form filler? Yeah. What is that work that you're doing when you're finishing your note, when you're clicking box after box after box after box? What are you doing? Are you filling out a form? Are you building a temple of majesty? Are you providing health to the suffering of the world. We all need to figure that out. Yeah? What do you think you're doing? So that definition was, all of us have it, that it has to do with meaning, and it has to do with relationship. So this is a patient of mine and his wife, and this is about relationship. Rachel said also, healing is accomplished not by experts, but by human beings. So we have to bring our expertise into the room, but we exist there as fellow humans. Part of our relationship with someone is the promise of non-abandonment. We have to, in some way, figure out how to promise not to leave people because someone else is going to come in, because we're part of the healthcare system, or because we're going to actually be there ourselves. Helen Luke said, no man can safely enter the dark gate of the shadow world without knowing that some deeply loved or trusted person has absolute faith in the rightness of his journey and in his courage and ability to come through. That's us. We can be there. We have to be there for people to be able to trust. And so now we circle back to this issue of grief and what we do with all the sadness. The expectation that we can be immersed in suffering and loss daily and not be touched by it is as unrealistic as expecting to be able to walk through water without getting wet. We burn out not because we don't care, but because we don't grieve. We burn out because we have allowed our hearts to become so filled with loss that we have no room left to care. And here is the paradox. The context of our burnout is also the source of our sustenance. It is the intensity, it is the loss, it is the sadness that if we can engage with, we can be filled. We can be sustained. It is through the connection and the relationship, not pushing away the relationship, but drawing it towards us, moving towards the brokenness. Henry Nouwen wrote about a Leonard Bernstein play that was about the assassination of John F. Kennedy. I never knew broken glass could shine so brightly. So this beautiful chalice was shattered. That's true, and that loss happened, and that was real. But look what was left. The shining shards that were left were a new kind of brightness. In the psychological literature, they call this bidirectionality exquisite empathy. So they looked at people who dealt with horrible, horrible traumas. And they found that there were some people who were able to do it in an ongoing and sustainable, fulfilling way. And those clinicians had a very well-attuned ability to remain empathic, empathetic, and to be invigorated by what they were doing because they were able to manage the play between connection and distance. So ultimately, then we're left with what would be called relationship-centered care, not patient-centered care. Patient-centered care goes a long way, but it doesn't go far enough because it excludes us in the room. We are real. We are humans who have a spirituality. Meaning means a lot to us, as does connection. So this is my daughter before surgery a few years ago. She ended up doing just fine. But when you walk into a room and see her, and know that she's got two parents who feel the same way preoperatively, you have to know that this is a human interaction. This is a human encounter. And we need to bring our whole selves to this endeavor. I want to read you a short piece, parts of a piece by someone named Michael Radetzky. I think he's in Washington State now. It's called Sudden Intimacies. Sudden Intimacies. What fulfills the physician? Certainly the diagnostic challenge, the financial security, the altruistic glow, and the grateful thanks all provide a measure of satisfaction. But all too often, success becomes bracketed by failure. A deluge of new information erodes the sense of professional mastery. Money ceases to compensate fully for the time and toil. The good one attempts to do goes awry, and the thankfulness of patients becomes admixed with fear and suspicion. For me, fulfillment comes from the sudden intimacies with total strangers. Those moments when the human barrier cracks open to reveal what is most secret and inarticulate. A word can betray the deepest emotion. A look can reflect a world of feeling. Illness strips away superficiality to reveal reality in etched detail. This revelation can fuse together disparate lives in unexpected kinship. This is the physician's privilege. To be lifted out of the dross of common days in order to experience such clarity of feeling. The intensity of birth and death, pleasure and sorrow, as expressed in the lives of others, has the power to nullify personal barriers in sudden communion. Then the world is seen in its proper proportions, and the tenuous miracle of existence is underscored. Surely, it must profit us to feel this deeply, with the hope that somehow, in the sweep of that feeling, we might yet learn to appreciate the wondrous happenings of our own lives. So to do this work, we need to be in right relationship. We need to appreciate sudden intimacies. We need to have self-knowledge and dual awareness, both attend to and monitor the needs of the patient, the work environment, and our own subjective experience. So that service is not sacrifice. Service ends up being the overflowing of your intention. Service is the overflowing of your own intention to do good in the world. So full, I want everyone in this room so full that there's enough to flow over onto others. To be fully human and to be a presence, a man must have some equivalent of contemplation, some experience with reflection or meditation that can give time for the inner self to expand. Love is not a mechanical act. It is an overflowing of carefully gathered treasure. Cardinal Berland said, we can only give from what we have. So my last two slides. This is a patient of mine, Mary Jane, gave me her permission to show her photo and this poem that she wrote that was graffitied onto a wall. Please don't turn her in. She has been living with metastatic breast cancer for 22 years. Everything takes longer than you think it should, thought it would, except your life. Right? So we can end then with Mary Oliver and her invitation to all of us. Tell me what it is you plan to do with your one wild and precious life. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Rabow. That was wonderful. We have a few moments for questions. Does anybody have anything they would like to ask?
It might be, thank you very much for a great talk. It might be really obvious, but could you explain how a gratitude circle operationalizes?
Sure. It's not obvious. So at the end of our meeting, I say it's time for us to bring our meeting to a close. Can everyone take a moment to think about something that you're grateful for from the last few days or week? And so then everyone doesn't talk for a few moments, and theoretically people are thinking about something they're grateful for. And then I turn to my left, so beware of sitting on my left. And someone starts, and they say literally just a word or a half a sentence about something they're grateful for. I'm grateful for the weather. My sister is visiting from out of town. I'm grateful to her. Whatever it is that they're grateful for. And we go around the room, and everyone says something. Sometimes people are grateful for other people in the room. I'm grateful to so-and-so who really helped me out this week with a patient. People talk about people in the room. People talk about folks outside of the room. And it goes from sort of superficial things. Some people are grateful for muffins. And it goes all the way to very, very deep things that people are grateful for. And I think that, like a lot of practice, all practices maybe, the benefit is in what's been called growing new eyes to see, that you start to train yourself to see, to have gratitude. And at first you may say, I'm not grateful for anything. It's been a crappy week. And you keep pushing yourself to think about some little thing that you're grateful for. And all of a sudden you start seeing more and more things. And you can actually start to see them in real time. So instead of just once a week looking back saying, oh, that was pretty cool what happened on Tuesday. When it happens on Tuesday, you can appreciate that something beautiful, miraculous is happening right then.
Something new to end staff meetings with.
Yep.
Does anybody else have any other questions? Matt's got you.
Thank you. So beautifully articulated. You speak about palliative care and the work of the clinician physician as, in some ways, someone who offers their own hope to someone else. You didn't say that exactly, but you alluded to that. And also the question or the quote that I think some of us have heard, hope does not lie in a way out, but in a way through. Could you say a bit more about that?
Yeah. So I guess I think all of us struggle with how to define hope. And people use it colloquially in the hospital setting, you know, is there any hope? I think that our jobs ultimately are pushing people to be a little bit more explicit and potentially a little bit more realistic about what they're hoping for. So in some ways, the question, what do you hope for, is not as important as the follow-up question, which is, what else might you hope for? Because in some ways, at least in a trivial way, we all hope for, yeah, I hope my loved one gets out of the ICU and dances a jig, you know, and is just cured. I hope for these things, which may not be realistic. So in some ways, the follow-up question is, well, if that isn't possible, what else do you hope for? Well, I hope that if they, you know, if they're not going to leave the ICU, at least that they can see a sunrise tomorrow morning. This idea about hopes being nested. And my own paternal grandfather was also not a, I came from a long line of not very touchy-feely people. Not a very touchy-feely guy who, when he got end-stage cancer, we all thought that he was going to, you know, punch someone and die. Like, that was how we thought it was going to go for him. But he ended up asking to be wheeled outside to watch the sunset on the last day before he died. So there was something else that we were able to hope for, that he was able to hope for. And not so much thinking about what I hope for, that I could offer even. It's more, I think, of an invitation to let people think about what is possible. The other definition that I like about hope is what is possible. And so it sort of cuts to this issue of, is it realistic or not realistic hope? It's just what you think is possible. And if you can hold that idea of possibility, then you can hold that hope. As people lose more and more, they're still are things that they can hope for, and ultimately they may hope for a peaceful dying at the very end when all their other hopes have been exhausted. I do think hope is something that we all have to struggle with. I think that we have to force ourselves not to just accept the first thing that people say and push ourselves to want to know more. Because I think everyone has nested hopes. And we have to sort of push on through to there. Yeah.
Are there any more questions for Dr. Rabow? All right. Well, thank you all for coming. Have some more coffee.